Hello, my dear friends of the Co-Cathedral of St. John. We come together in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and the Holy Spirit. The Lord be with you. So here we are in our lovely, beautiful church, and so grateful for our many visitors who remind me and express their gratitude for this presence of the mystery of love revealed in such a lovely way. So you need to be mindful of it too, even though many of you are not able to be here. So I'm holding a little booklet that we're giving out free for Lent. It's called Sacred Space. It's done by some Jesuits. It says the Irish Jesuits. I didn't pick it out, but I'm happy to see that. And so it's just a little tool, you know, and we need something. So I'm encouraging you to pick this up or go online, find your own kind of path for Lent. Because next Wednesday, the 17th, we begin. But I just want to read a little bit from this as an introduction and an encouragement for you to pick one of these up. They're available in the gathering space and at the parish center at the office. So it has a lot of scripture, so the gospel of the day, and then it has a little kind of steps as a method to reflect on the word, on the gospel. But here's the little one, freedom. St. Ignatius thought that a thick and shapeless tree trunk would never believe that it could become a statue. Admired as a miracle of sculpture, he was. And would never submit itself to the chisel of the sculptor, who sees by her genius what she can make of it. I ask for the grace to let myself be shaped by my loving Creator. So part of this journey of Lent is to be shaped, is to be formed. This reminds me of that message in the book of Jeremiah, where Jeremiah talks about a potter, and the potter has the clay, and he doesn't throw the clay away, like God doesn't throw us away, but he puts it back on the spin and reshapes and remolds and continues to work to bring about the beauty of the way we are made in our humanity. And that is really important for us, to acknowledge that God doesn't throw us away. You know, we have this throwaway culture. So we get in a mentality, we're not worth so much. Dangerous. That's the evil one. That's darkness that seeps in. It doesn't allow us to be filled with hope and new possibilities because of God's love and because of the potter of God's love. Or, like Ignatius is saying here, we can look at this shapeless, thick, a tree trunk and think it's useless, has no value, has no purpose, and yet imagine what a sculptor can do with it. And Ignatius gives us that clear reminder. So on that journey to Jerusalem during Lent, I'm just asking, you know, maybe pray the rosary every day. Find some devotional way. I remember my mother, you know, in the evening, at night, before she went to bed, she would bring out this little stack of devotional prayers and devotional reflections and sit and read it. So inspiring. And obviously she recognized the need, and she was being shaped and formed by the love of God and the embrace of Jesus Christ. So on Ash Wednesday, well, maybe I read another little thing from my little book here. In this expectant state of mind, so Ignatius is saying, when you read the scripture and you really stay with it, you have an expectant state of mind. Please turn to the text for the day. Believe that the Holy Spirit is present and may reveal whatever the passage has to say to you. Read it reflectively, listening with a third ear to what may be going on in your heart. Now, this requires a little bit of discipline. Maybe it's 5 minutes, but And you know, the only way that we do this is you've got to make a decision. And it has to be firm and clear. And you have to have the conviction that I need this 5 minutes, I need this 10 minutes to set it aside and to be true. And my humanity, my person, will come alive. Can't measure, don't have to get all fussed up about figuring out is something happening to me or not. Trust that something is happening to you on the way to Jerusalem. So we will be having, the five opportunities for a station. There are two masses and three liturgy of the word with ashes. And this year, because of COVID, Rome has sent out a message, we're going to sprinkle some ashes on the top of your head as a way to be safe and not to be touching everyone. Also, after the 12:10, when the Mass will be at 12:10, and people will be here, then in the chapel, like we did Christmas Eve for communion, we will be offering stations in the chapel. So you could come in the north door off from 4th Avenue, pardon me, and then go through the chapel and go out the other door. And we'll have someone there to offer ashes for any of you who say, gosh, either the 12:10 was full or whatever the circumstance may be, we'd like to really help you with that. Also, we will be live streaming the Stations of the Cross on Fridays. So you can come on in and join us for that. You know, it's usually about a half an hour. And, again, during Lent, it's a beautiful call to really pay attention and let your heart be touched by that. And maybe you have your own particular way you like to experience Lent. And that's perfectly fine, of course. It's just to try to stir you up a little bit so you would make some decision and you would decide as a family, what are you going to do as a family with your kids, with your children? So formative, such an opportunity. I can remember growing up, we were farmers, so we had to go milk the cows. But after what we called supper, because dinner on a farm was at noon. So after supper, kneel right down in the kitchen, and there we were, right, on the kitchen floor, praying the rosary. And I love that my parents made those kind of decisions, and that we were like the clay with the potter, and something was happening to us, even though we didn't think it was always such a great idea, because we had things to do. My siblings used to say, well, let Jerry lead it because he goes faster. So I don't know if that was such a beautiful thing or not. Maybe they were just exaggerating. Lastly, we have CMA. You should be receiving your letter from Bishop Quinn. And you might be saying, well, COVID, what the heck? But it's just like our parish. We have the same needs and actually more needs during COVID because of reaching out, because of a staff. Bishop Quinn has the curia. You know, they all work either remotely or however, and yet they need salaries, they need benefits, and there they are. And also him, he doesn't have a place for a collection, so we support his house and we support his salary, Bishop Quinn, and all of his staff and the people that are there at the Pastoral Center in Winona. So I just encourage you. And when I think about the Diocese of Winona, you know, the bankruptcy piece is taking another step. And so you may hear something about this in the media, I'm not sure, but it's being filed, and then the judge will make that decision about whether they're accepting what has been prepared and offered. So we need to take a step. It's been a long journey. I apologize again. I am sorry for the horrific abuse that has taken place by priests and others, and the fact that there was no accountability, and there was such a minimal confrontation for the illness, the horrible sickness that someone had, and they were trusted with children. So that is unfolding, and there will be more to say about that, because I want to be very transparent about what's happening with the bankruptcy. Thank you. I'm looking forward to Lent. You know, we have this weather, and I love the sun that happens in this very frigid weather. I would prefer not to have the weather, the frigid weather, but the sun is glorious, and it just lifts my heart, and it gives a little, takes a little edge off from that bitterness, because the sky and the sun is beautiful. Matter of fact, here I am in the church right now. There's a little sun coming in here. I'm happy about that. The Lord be with you. And may Almighty God bless you, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. God's peace to you. I look forward to our journey during Lent.